I got a good one for you today. Justin from Real Analysis joins me to talk all things Snyder Cut and Batman vs. Superman. The man that made the Man of Steel Thesis video. Lots of you will recognize him, and if you haven't subscribed to him yet, what are you waiting for? Go subscribe to him. He makes very good videos, much better than mine. But let's get on to the show. Kick back, relax, or get something done while listening, and enjoy the show. All right, I got a special Highball podcast for you guys. Today, I got Justin from Real Analysis, the legend who made the Man of Steel thesis on why Zack Snyder is obsessed with phallic imagery. And he's here today to talk all things, Zack Snyder, Snyder Cut, BVS, I guess whatever else we're going to get on. But yeah, man, good to have you on here.
Thank you, man. Legend. That's a big word.
Don't be too humbled. All right.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought up the phallic imagery right away, because that, that's gets that elephant out of the room,
Dude, that was the first thing I noticed about those videos. I was like, I wasn't the only one seeing that. I was very happy that you did that.
right. I mean, it's a source for a lot of, haters joking about like the phallic imagery and stuff, but it was interesting to see that it's actually like part of like the structure he intended, it was pretty cool.
It's great what Zack Snyder did. I don't know where you want to start first. I mean, obviously the Snyder Cut stuff's huge, and I remember watching your video about Justice League when it came out. I think it was called a Mona Lisa or something like that. You were so dead on, man. We were just assuming that was like 20% of the movie, but they changed like 50% of the movie.
It became actually it was apparent right in the first shot, wasn't it? Like right when you see Superman in that video. Like I was still in denial at that point, but I should have known right in the beginning, I think, that something's going bad here.
the mustache totally gave it away. I was still in denial for about the first 4 days.
Really? It was too much. You're like, it's good.
It's so good. Big smile. No.
Right. It just got ridiculous, though. Some of the lines and I don't know, and the faces that Batman makes and things like that. It's just like at some point during the movie, I was like, oh, okay, I see what's happening here, And just kind of accepted that for what it was.
So by that time, did you even think there was like a Snyder Cut? I mean, I think I kind of knew right away that he had something else, like either a longer cut or a completely different movie.
Right. I mean, isn't it like fact that he started working on it before BVS was even released? They were well into it, So. They had a significant amount.
They started principal photography, I think, 2 weeks after BVS came out in theaters like that. And they ended in October of 2016. So he left in May 2017. So that's like a long time post-production as well. So he definitely had something. And it's very apparent now.
it's clear every post he makes, how far down along they were with that movie. And, it just goes to show that there is something. Like, the first question is, does a Snyder Cut exist? Yes, right?
Yeah.
There is something there. There is much more story to tell, and it's already pretty much captured.
100%. And, that Sunday was incredible. I really wasn't thinking that many people were going to tweet about this. And the second they broke that 214,000 mark, it just skyrocketed. Almost got to like a million in a day.
Right. I wasn't even sure like what was going on until that day I saw the Snyder Cut people, say today's the big day, we got to tweet something, about the Snyder Cut. I was like, okay, I'm on board, and I just kind of jumped on the bandwagon too there.
I'm glad.
I mean, we got to push for it. We got to make noise, because like the big thing, I feel like for BVS, there's too much noise. There was too much negative noise, so that WB sort of like they got scared from that.
Yeah.
But if we bring positive noise, they're gonna wanna, they're gonna see that. It definitely makes a difference.
That was something Zack Snyder was talking about at the Snyder Con when he was talking about his original Justice League script, and they got scared out doing it because of the reaction to BVS.
Right. And so, really, I mean, my point of view is I don't really blame, like, it doesn't surprise me that WB made that move. It's more like the overreaction to BVS is what I really blame, like the critics and the haters, pretty much. You know, they really viciously attacked that, like, irrationally so. Yeah. So, and then of course WB being a business, they're gonna, you know, get cold feet, and you know, they're all about money at the end of the day. But you know, they did give us Man of Steel and Batman v Superman too. So it's like they're willing to, but you know, if the rhetoric and the noise surrounding the films is gonna be as crazy as it was for BVS, of course they're gonna get scared and kind of run off. So I mostly blame the critics for bashing it to holy hell, you know, when it came out, and giving it like some ridiculous score of like 20-something%. So,
yeah,
I mean, it's sort of to be expected, really.
Yeah, I was very much hating on the critics as well.
Yeah,
because there's so many worse films that come out. Like oh, it's not even comparable, really.
It becomes more apparent how like out of touch the critics are when there's more and more movies where like the audience score and the critic score are so vastly different. So, you know, in specifically for BVS, like it's clear, right? But even like some of the Star Wars movies, it's and I think even Captain Marvel and things, like there's so many instances where the critics are so like not in touch with the audience kind of point of view. And if you look at the audience score for BVS, it actually makes much more sense than the critic score, you know. So if like the audience actually got it pretty right, in my opinion.
I think it's like around the 65% mark for the audience or something like that.
Oh yeah. So okay.
It's majority positive. It makes more sense.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Right. But 20-something%, I don't know what it's at, but it's just too ridiculous, you know.
Yeah. There's no doubt it was a divisive film, but yeah, I think that's what makes it great at the end of the day. I mean, if it was just a standard superhero film, you wouldn't have made videos about it. You know, nobody would be talking about it.
Yeah. I mean, those standard movies, they're just so boring. It's like you get done watching them in the theater. You can put it in a box and say that movie was about this and it makes sense and call it a day and then never talk about the movie again. You know, I prefer movies like BVS where, you know, it takes you places and then kind of, you know, has random things like when the Flash comes.
Yeah.
And Bruce is like, nobody was ready for that.
Right.
When that happened in the movie, everyone was like, what is going on? But you want that sort of like, I don't know. Can I cuss on your thing?
Yeah, sure.
But yeah. You want that mind fuck while you're in the movie where you can actually feel like you're experiencing something rather than just kind of passively watching some visuals on a screen and then calling it a day after that, you know? But so BVS does that. And, you know, we need more movies that do that, basically.
Yeah, BVS came out 2016. We're still talking about it. And another film that we haven't even seen, we're still talking about it 2 years later, you know?
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah, everyone's clamoring for this thing. And we're just getting, like, these visuals every once in a while that blows my mind. Yeah. Like, even just one shot of the movie that didn't come out just completely blows my mind. Like, the whole General Swanwick is – Martian Manhunter.
Yeah, like, insane.
Because then you look at like Man of Steel and BVS and you're like, now you watch it through a different lens. And I love movies like that where you're like, you come back to it, you watch it, your perspective changes, and it's like a whole new movie almost, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah,
it actually makes more sense for Man of Steel because that moment when Swanwick is talking to him through the glass, it's like,
yeah,
Swanwick doesn't look nervous at all. It's like he kind of,
I know. Right, right.
Take Superman or something.
Right, right, right. And even in when they're in the desert and you know, the ship's coming down from, you know, to pick up Superman and Lois is with him and stuff. And they show like the doctor and he's like completely mind blown. And General Swanwick is just like standing there like, interesting. You know, it's like, okay, this makes sense. This makes sense.
Yeah, and it's something you wouldn't even catch the first time around. It's like very apparent now going back and watching the film.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, we need to see what the full scope is. So we need the Snyder Cut, you know, we need that. So I don't know. I mean, it's great that we have this push. We need more, I think. The whole, you know, Ben Affleck and Gal Gadot tweeting, like that's a huge, huge deal. And that's like, that was such a like monumental moment in the movement, I think. So it was really good.
Yeah, a bunch of articles were coming out today or the other day, and they're talking about how WB is planning to release it on HBO Max. It's like a rumor right now, nothing official.
Yeah, right. I mean, but where's this rumor even coming from, you know?
I know. All kinds of sources.
Yeah.
But
it's got a source, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I hope there are at least, like, some in that direction, right? Like, WB's thinking about it. Like, especially after the last weekend, when you have the whole cast and crew just coming out and wanting it, and you have a million fans that wanted to, it seems like a no-brainer for them right now. Like, I can understand, like, last year when barely anybody was really talking about it, none of the cast was talking about it, but, I mean, it's pretty, you know, easy money right now. Even if it's not, like, 100% done, I think they could release what they have, and it'd be fine.
I'd be fine watching whatever they have, you know. I think WB, for like my most realistic perspective on it, is WB is a business, and they see the potential of the Snyder Cut, and they want to release it at the right time. So they're probably like, you know, just looking at what's happening and like wondering when is the right time. Because I feel like they're also kind of comfortable with what they're doing right now. Like they're kind of comfortable with like the whole, like, I don't know, Shazam stuff and the new Wonder Woman movie that's coming and, you know, and the new Batman and all of that. So they're comfortable releasing the stuff they are right now. But like, I think at a point people will get tired of that naturally. And then, so they'll want to release it. Or, the other flip side of it is there's so much noise about the Snyder Cut that pushes them to release it earlier. So like my point of view is like they will release the Snyder Cut, you know, like that's just something they have that has a lot of interest and that could make them a lot of money. Like, why wouldn't they release that? Yeah. It's just a matter of, for me, it's a matter of when. Like the more we push, all that means is that they might release it earlier rather than like much later down the road. So, you know, getting it out earlier, like all of that noise we're making, that like that's great. That like that should help, I think.
Yeah, I'm really hoping, really pulling for that. There's, I think the day before the whole Sunday thing happened, so like that Saturday or Friday.
Yeah.
A lot of people were around, you know, Zach's circle, I guess you could say, were coming out and saying something big is going to happen Sunday. And then something big happens. So, you know, somebody has a source with Zach.
That's true. I mean, you actually have Ben Affleck and Gal Gadot and Snyder himself, like, tweeting out, release the Snyder Cut. Like, this is huge to get, like, these big names to actually, you know, support it.
And it had to have been coordinated. At least I'm thinking, like, they had to talk to each other.
That's
right?
True. That's true.
It's just not a coincidence.
And then there's this one weird thing, like what's up with Henry Cavill? Like why didn't he come out and tweet about it? But like Cyborg, you got Batman, you got Wonder Woman, you got all the people tweeting. And then I don't know, I guess later Henry Cavill said something about he's still like Superman, he's got it in the closet or something. I know he's doing the whole The Wicker, or what?
Witcher.
What show is he? Witcher, yeah, Witcher Man or something. The Witcher. I don't even know. But that one's coming on Netflix, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So he's probably busy with that, I would imagine. So.
I would assume.
Or, yeah, promotionally, yeah.
But like, still, like Ben Affleck, like.
Oh yeah, most, I mean.
Like, WB's golden boy.
Yeah, that's so true. That's true. Yeah, that's an important one for sure.
Pretty cool. But yeah, I definitely want to see the Snyder Cut. After every image you've been posting about this, I think Cyborg Origin is like the one thing that I want to see the most that was cut out from it.
Well, they say that's the heart of the movie, you know, and from what the images he's released, I can definitely see how that works, you know. His whole family. Yeah. Because in the movie, they made it like everything's chipper, you know, his dad's there at the end and all is good, you know, great, call it a day, you know. But, you know, Snyder's version would actually have like some emotional like weight to it and something that actually challenges the characters and you know, something more important to say maybe, you know. So
there's an interesting thing Zack Snyder said about the movie. He said he had several different cuts of it. Now, I'm thinking he had a trilogy cut, like a Justice League trilogy type cut, where he was going to have a bunch of, you know, story links that started in this Justice League movie that was going to continue on through a couple other movies.
You think he filmed it all, or you think he just had the story for it, or what?
I'm thinking he had something set up, like for future movies. I think that's where Darkseid comes in. And I don't know if the 214-minute cut is that cut or it's like the cut he wants to show people. I assume it's the one he wants to show people because he put that on the poster.
Right, and he circled it or something. And yeah, right.
And it would be tough to get sequels to that. I mean, you know what I'm saying? So they have to put out a version that is still compromised, that, you know, they still have to edit out some stuff from his original cut of the movie, right?
Oh, why would they do that?
Because he would be setting up for other movies inside.
Well, exactly.
Movie.
Right. I mean,
they would leave that stuff in. And then
well, if we don't get that, then that's not technically the Snyder cut, right? I mean, I feel like that's another, like, you know, situation that they find themselves in where if the Snyder cut gets released, let's say it is completed, technically, if it is like the full on Snyder cut, like it's just going to have people clamoring for, you know, for them to go in that direction again, you know, like what if they don't want to? So it's like hard to, I don't know. I feel like they're really, I have no idea what's going on. So it's just pure speculation on my part. So
it's all is.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, and I would love to see it. But I imagine if they actually did, then people would just be like, release the second and third part of the, you know, Justice League trilogy or whatever, you know?
I mean, which is still a possibility. It's not like it was that long ago, you know?
right. Yeah.
But yeah, you want to talk more about BVS or something? Or because I see you got some videos out, and I'm waiting for that big, like, thesis, like hour-long video. Oh,
man, it's like I'm trying, but it's so intense, the level of detail they put in this movie. Because it almost, like, exploring BVS kind of opens up my eyes to some type of symbolism that's in other films. Like, I've brought up before that, like, Ballad of Buster Scruggs actually has a lot of, visual and symbolic similarities to BVS. I don't know if you've seen Ballad of Buster Scruggs, but it's on Netflix. And that's one of the Coen Brothers movies. It's a really good movie, probably one of their best, I think. But, you know, both deal with themes of death and sort of resurrection and opposites and things like that. So, you know, you actually notice these parallels even through a movie that you wouldn't expect to kind of share that, but they do, you know. So there's like a lot of tangents down this rabbit hole of trying to analyze BVS, because it starts opening like the kind of the world of symbolism as like in a broader sense. So that's, it's easy to get sort of stuck down various paths, right, as you're trying to analyze something like BVS, because, you know, it's so big. It's just really abstract ideas and like religious ideas and spiritual ideas and all of that stuff. So, and a lot of like trying to understand that has to come from like actually me learning about stuff that I actually haven't delved in myself, right? So like part of the process for me is actually finding the material and the influences, learning it, and then formulating a picture around it that makes sense for the movie. And that takes forever, because, you know, he's even talked about Nietzsche and all of like that influence, and, you know, Joseph Campbell and the hero's journey and you know, Carl Jung and all of this. And so in all of those people and more have like these giant tomes of material to read that's like super dense and super like way past my level, you know. But, you know, I'm basically just going in there little by little, trying to peel back as much as I can, you know, because what else is there to do? There's no Snyder cut yet. Right. So I might as well just watch BVS over and over again, you know. Yeah. I don't have a problem with that.
I guess you could say it's your white whale that you're chasing.
Yeah, just a bit. Yeah. Hopefully it doesn't eat me up, and, you know, hopefully it's not a suicidal mission or anything.
Obsessed
with
this guy.
Right. Yeah. So actually, to that point, I've distanced myself from the movie for a while, because, you know, if you're trying, it's like if you think about it like an art piece, you're looking at a painting. If you look too closely, you know, you miss the broad picture, right? So like I'm trying to distance myself from it, so when I come back and watch it, then, you know, hopefully something more will come.
Come back at it with fresh eyes.
stuff. Because you know, you stick too close to it, you get kind of stuck in one way of thinking about it. But if you distance yourself, then you know you got those fresh eyes that you're talking about. That really helps.
Kind of how like everybody that watched the movie the first time got stuck on the Martha thing.
Oh yeah.
they just get stuck on that. They miss the whole other movie that's happening.
Yeah. It was a really silly thing to get stuck on for people, I think.
I don't think Zach thought it was going to be like that big of a moment for people. Like, I really thought he was like, no, they're going to get it. I don't have to explain that much.
Well, he sort of went in that route. Like, he did the whole flashback thing in that moment where you kind of get a sense for what it's about. And, you know, people are stuck on this, oh, well, they have the same mother's name, so they're friends now. And that really...
It's not the idea, but...
it's like Snyder can only do so much. Like, he flashed back to the gunman. And there Batman is with the weapon himself, you know, over this guy, you know. So it's like there's the clear parallel. But, yeah, a lot of people are just not... like taking that extra step. I think it's just they kind of want to hate on it too.
Yeah,
it's not about like actually believing that Snyder would just make them best friends because their mothers have the same name. Obviously, I don't think they even believe that. I think it's just something to kind of inject, just to make fun of the film, you know.
Yeah, it's just something to change Batman's thought pattern. You know, it's just something to change the track he's on.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, if for someone that's in a deep, deep obsession about Superman, you know, you need something to jolt him out of that. Yeah. Right. So it kind of makes sense.
And Batman has that spear just like a harpoon. Superman, the white whale.
Oh, yeah.
So many white whales.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Lots of white whales.
I love that video you made about it, by the way.
I started seeing
it all over the movie.
I know, right? Yeah. Like, especially that, like, where the scout ship is, like, that looks like to me. Like, what else? Because it looks like a weird shape, right? And then it dawned on me, like that kind of looks like a whale.
Yeah.
And then I start reading about, you know, the hero's journey and the whole belly of the whale thing. And he's talked about that. So I'm like, oh, I see what's going on here. Like, I kind of like get like what he's doing with it. Just a little bit, even though, like, you know, there's so much more. But still, like, that was a really cool thing to see. Yeah.
The symbolism to wrap your brain. It's just amazing. I wonder, like, if Chris Terrio was involved with that in the script writing process.
Sure. For sure. Yeah, I know because actually I went to the Snyder event, the director's cuts. I was there. I got to meet him and everything. I actually asked him one question. I was like, in person, I was asking about the influence for the film, like various things, like, okay, you got the Hero with a Thousand Faces by Joseph Campbell. And then I was like, what about Carl Jung? Have you guys like, is that like something you guys talked about? And he was like, yeah, that's something we definitely discussed with Terrio and stuff. So I think they're really close with these themes, and they really bounced a lot of ideas off each other. Cause I know even the Martha thing, he said Chris Terrio pointed that out to him. Nice. Right. Even during the Snyder event, he said that, like, when someone asked him about it, he was like, Chris Terrio just kind of like casually was like, hey, did you know they have the same name? Or he's like, oh yeah, that's right, they do have the same name. And then they kind of bounced ideas. So I'm sure, yeah, they probably had a lot of discussions on that sort of theme. Yeah.
So many awesome themes in that movie. It's really, really dense.
Very, yeah.
And I know a lot of people like to focus on the Jesus imagery that's happening.
Right.
It seems like that's all people want to see sometimes. Like,
well, because that's, yeah, I mean, heavy, within but, this I mean, culture, within this yeah. culture, that's the most obvious thing someone can see. And I think a lot of people mistake people make is just because they can see it, obviously, then that means that's all there is to it. Right. Because there's actually a lot more to it than that. Right. So it's like people see the Jesus imagery and think maybe it's heavy handed, but you know, there's all this other stuff that they haven't seen. So it's really, they're seeing what they're familiar with and then thinking that's all there is to it, rather than taking the extra step and being like, well, maybe there's something more to it. Mm-hmm. You know, even just simply asking that question. I think a lot of people get in this mode where they react to a movie the first time they've seen it, and that's the reaction, and they're kind of stuck in that point of view. rather than ever entertaining, like, maybe there's something more to this. Maybe, you know, maybe it doesn't mean what I think it means. Maybe, you know, people typically, at least the critics, I would say, because remember, the audience score was actually a little bit more decent than the critics were. So the critics, I think, which I don't get, because the critics, they're film. They're supposed to be lovers of film. Yeah. And they seem to hate film. they seem to hate when people actually try to challenge their point of view or their expectations for what the movie should be. So I don't know. It's a little weird, but yeah, like all people have to do is just take a step back, maybe watch the movie a couple more times, think about it, and, you know, see if there's a different perspective that you might be open to, you know, rather than, like, you know, sticking into your own perspective after one viewing and then immediately just bashing it, you know, like that was just crazy.
Yeah, Zack Snyder is such a visual storyteller. You could always pick up on more things, you know, the more times you watch a movie. And there was I feel like a lot of the scenes, like what's in the background, what's happening is trying to tell the story of what's going on in that scene at the moment, right?
Right.
Some shots, like in Man of Steel, he's in the church with the stained glass window behind.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of people just see Jesus, but the window is about Jesus asking God for, like, advice or something like that, or help or something like
right.
He's talking to the Father in the church. It's very kind of on the nose. But
like, that's true. Well, I feel like that, for me, stuff like that just tells me he's excited about the using all of that symbolism, because just as much obvious symbolism as there is very subtle symbolism. And really it's like, he doesn't have, like, I don't know. It doesn't seem like he has like a need to make everything subtle, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I feel like that's more of a pretentious way to go about it. Like, everything has to be subtle. Like, sometimes, you know, you can just do something cause it looks cool and it works for the themes. And then, you know, and then, so he doesn't really have a bias in that sense. And that really makes his films a little bit more, I don't know, less pretentious than something that's, like, you know, trying to get, you know, an Oscar or something, or, you know, whatever. But even if you look at that scene, you see the Father also has, like, this giant cross behind him over his shoulder. So over the Father's shoulder, he's got this giant cross. Over Superman's shoulder, it's like Jesus coming out of his shoulder. You know, it's pretty interesting. Yeah.
And that's what people, like, complain the most about Zack Snyder. They call him pretentious and stuff, which is just crazy to me.
It makes no sense, because how can you be pretentious and have, like, these awesome action scenes as well? Like, pretentious,
crazy shit happens in this movie.
Exactly. Yeah. He's not trying to be like, oh, this film is better, or this film is, like, this film can't be fun and interesting and just awesome for awesome sake. He's saying it could be all of that and more, you know, and people kind of get stuck on the theme. So I don't know. I feel like a lot of the criticism sort of cancels itself out. Like, even in Watchmen, you would have, like, half the people say any good thing just follows is because he's following the comics directly. And then any bad thing is just because he didn't understand the graphic novel. Well, how if he followed the novel exactly, then how can you get to this point where he doesn't understand anything if he's following it so closely? How does that even make any sense? Right. You know, it's like if he's doing it shot for shot and, you know, word by word, how is that just totally missing the point of Watchmen? Like, how does that ever work? But they say these things as if it makes sense, but it doesn't, you know? So I feel like a lot of the criticism is really based on, they just don't like the point of view being shown, and there's, like, this immediate rejection of it. And so they kind of try and rationalize, but sometimes that rationalization is self-contradictory, you know? So,
I mean, to a lot of people, there has to be only, like, two kinds of people. You're either, like, a Republican or a Democrat. Like, you know,
they
force, like, Zack Snyder in that, you know, that position where they put, like, he's this Ayn Randian fucking Republican that is a bloodthirsty maniac or something.
Yeah. Well, that's kind of a big point is people want to box things into a particular category. And if they can't, then they'll force it into a particular category and hate it usually. But the whole idea of BVS is, first of all, absolutes, like diamond absolutes, and that being kind of like a flawed way of thinking. And the idea that, you know, like if you've seen that shirt, he says all the gods, all the heavens, all the hells are within you. Right. And that's a Zack Snyder shirt thing, and he's quoting like Campbell and all of that. Yep. So he's coming from the point of view that in one individual, in one thing, can be many things, many opposing things, many contradictory things, and kind of how to navigate in that kind of complexity of these opposites, and the fact that each person kind of has a manifestation of all of them in some varying degree. But that worldview is in BVS, I believe, and it's that type of thinking that people don't really like. They want things to be kind of clear cut and, you know, make sense right away. And if it doesn't, then, you know, screw it, you know, hate on it. You know, that's right. That seems to be like what they've been doing. So, yeah.
Yeah. Maybe, and it might just be like the specific type of audience that goes to these movies. I mean, you know, a lot of MCU fans and whatnot, they just go to these.
Yeah. Movies. Right. Yeah. I mean, MCU, I don't really know, because I can't really comment on the MCU because I haven't really seen their movies in a while. Yeah. Probably the last movie I saw was Black Panther.
Mm-hmm. Do you like that?
No. I have serious problems with that.
Me too.
Yeah. There's a lot I could say about that, and I've said a little bit on that in one of my videos. But I guess Black Panther was the last one, and then ever so often I'll check it out on Netflix. But I like Martin Scorsese. I totally understand him when he's like, I tried, but I can't get through those movies, because that's exactly how I feel when I would check out, like I checked out Doctor Strange. I just couldn't sit through it because, you know, it's always got to reference some either pop culture thing or be some joke thing after some emotional moment, because they're not comfortable kind of letting the emotion kind of be it, you know? And so they kind of, yeah. What were you going to say?
I was just going to say, I feel like the movies, I mean, this might be a little harsh, but I feel like the movies don't have a soul. Like there's nothing they feel empty almost the time.
Yeah.
I don't gain anything by watching them, really.
I feel exactly the same. I know exactly what you mean. That's why I stopped watching them. And, you know, I try to, in the effort to have an open mind, you know, every once in a while I might come back to it. And literally like 15 minutes in, I'm like, okay, they're still doing the same stuff. Like, and I just turn it off. So like, I understand where Martin Scorsese is coming from, definitely, because, you know, they are doing the same formula, and it's a formula that feels, yeah, it seems to work, right? And it does work. I mean, they make their money, right? So of course, why would they stop? But at the same time, it's like it feels deceptive in a way, because their humor, I don't mind humor, you know, like there's lots of funny movies out there, like that's not it. Even silly movies, like I'll watch silly movies, but to me there's got to be something honest about what's being shown. And if it's in the Marvel style, it usually feels like whenever they do that sort of thing, that like I can see right through to the committee that is trying to manipulate the audience into laughing, right? It's more of like laughter and comedy as a form of manipulation rather than like honest humor. Like if you've watched any of the Coen brothers, their humor is hilarious.
Yeah, raised in Arizona, man.
Oh yeah.
Great.
If you watch Ballad of Buster Scruggs too, it's the funniest stuff, I swear. And it feels like they think it's funny, and they think that you would think that their audience would think it's funny, at least, right? Yeah. It's not about manipulating you into laughing. Like when they do that, like I know in Black Panther, there was a scene where she's like, "What are those?" And it's like they took that meme, that like internet thing, and some committee was like, "Oh, this is what the kids say, so let's put that in there so we can get some laughs because they'll like that, right?" That's more manipulative because they don't actually think that's funny. They're just putting it in there for, you know, just to appeal to what they think we think is funny, what the general audience thinks is funny. So there's less honesty in the humor, and that's really the problem for me.
We're not here to harp on MCU.
Yeah. Let's let that one go.
Let's get back to the real cinema, and that's the season.
Right.
Aquaman, of course.
I mean, you saw Joker, right? How did you feel about that?
Joker was, personally for me, is damn near like perfect. It's everything I want to see in a comic book film, right? Especially about like a supervillain.
Right. Yeah. It was crazy. It was a crazy experience. Like during that train scene, I was just in it, you know, like where the lights are flashing and they're like bothering him and stuff. And yeah. Yeah, it was...
And I was actually a little startled when the gun went off. I was like, whoa.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. And I love how they worked in like the jokes as tragedy in the film. And,
oh, yeah.
And some is like when he tells his joke to the I forget his name, the guy.
Talk show guy. Show.
Yeah, the talk show guy. I forget his name, but
Robert De Niro.
Yeah, right. Yeah. He says his joke and then the punchline is like actually conveyed with the gunshot. And it's like, oh, that's pretty clever.
Yeah.
Like, that's actually really clever to like have that scene because he was telling a joke like how do you I forget how actually the wording. I would totally butcher it. But do you remember it?
What do you get when you cross like a mentally ill person with a society yeah. that. Treat him like shit.
yeah, exactly. Yeah, you get what you fucking deserve, and then bang, you know, yeah. that's the punch
joke. I mean, like,
yeah,
little,
I know, right? Yeah, I mean, there's truth to it, right? Yeah. There's a lot of truth to it. So, I mean, that's when you have moments like that where it's like a catharsis you can feel for the character, but also the audience kind of feels that cathartic release of you know, this truth that's mm-hmm. been said straight to the media's face. Like, I mean, I would love to say that to the media that tend to, you know, sensationalize things yeah. and
almost
like they did for this movie. Yeah, and they glorified it and they make these horrible like narratives that actually could cause danger and tragedy and things like that. And that's what they did for this movie. So it's even more relevant for that because they're like saying people are going to shoot people up and it was just madness, you know, just because of the movie. But all that ended up happening apparently was people going to the stairs and taking pictures.
Right.
So yeah, no, it's totally, I love movies like that that are totally relevant and smart and the symbolism. And again, that movie actually has, and you know, I could be seeing things, you know, at this point, I'm just seeing things everywhere, symbolism everywhere. But that movie, I really believe that movie, you know, the 11/11 thing that they talk about.
No, I'm not.
Do you buy into that or have you not heard about it?
I've not heard about it. Explain.
Oh, you haven't heard about it. Oh, really? Oh, okay. No, this like somebody, there's like this whole theory about the clock showing 11/11. Frequently throughout the movie, right?
So,
and so
exactly
that might be
that some,
oh, that's a good question, right? Yeah, like, exactly. Why is that? Is that simply coincidence? Like, because when you're all right, so if you're analyzing a movie, you see some pattern. It can either be coincidence or it's not. So how do you know if it's coincidence, or how do you know if it's just, you know, actually meaning something? I think I'm convinced that it actually does, despite the director's kind of reaction to it.
Yeah, he's lukewarm on everything. he's waiting for people to catch on or something like that.
Right. But he was like, oh, yeah, I don't think it means anything. Like, you know, why would you say you don't think it means anything? It either does or it doesn't based on what you did. So it's like he's being very kind of, I don't know, whatever about it. And
cool. It's being cool.
Yeah. What goes the word? So so I was looking at and if you actually look at the clock, right? The hand, when it goes to 11 on the left side is a little higher than the right.
Mm.
And again, be careful because I may be reading too much into it. I always entertain that fact. But the hand is a little bit higher on the left side than the right side when the clock shows 11/11, and it happens throughout the movie. But if you look at Joker's smile, his smile is in the same orientation.
Really?
And yeah.
Wow.
So the fact that his smile is in the same orientation as the clock being at 11/11, I feel like that's a little bit more than coincidence, you know?
So, yeah. But does it mean it's trying to signal that it's a dream state he's in, or?
Oh, that's, I have no idea. I've looked at 11/11 in various contexts, and strangely enough, I don't want to get too into it, but they also talk about it in Ballad of Buster Scruggs. They mention that, and there's a lot of things that can be said about it, but you know, I don't want to get too deep into it. But if you look at even his hands, when he's on the bus with the kid and the mother, and the mother's like, you know, get away from my kid. Oh. his arms are up closing, as if to be the number 11. So this all feels a little like conspiratorial at this point, right? Because it's like, you know, you're just seeing things everywhere. But at the same time, why are there clocks specifically in the shot? Because that's a director choice, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. I need this clock here at the top side of this door. And then I need it here on this door as well. And a completely different clock in the shot that he punches that also needs to say 11:11. It's like that seems unlikely to come through sheer chance. And then you have the aspect that his smile makes that same orientation with the hands. You'll have to look at the picture to even entertain what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And I might even do a side by side later, but and then he comes down the two buildings, and actually I don't want to get too much into it, because it goes back to BVS and to the Joker and to Ballad of Buster Scruggs. And a lot of it is the whole theme of there being like a left side and a right side, and this path in the center with the sun down in the center. That's some pretty common symbolism for kind of walking the path in between two things. And like if you look at Zack Snyder's shirt design,
yeah,
do you remember that?
Yeah.
So he has these two pillars, left and right. Right. So those two pillars represent opposites and all of that. And then what's in the center, there's like something in the center. There's like the way, the path, and that's through sacrifice. But because you see the sword going down, you see the casket, and there's like the death in the middle and all of that. And you connect that with, I'll do a side by side on this later in another video as well, but
yeah, we need to see that video.
For anybody listening, I'm going to clarify exactly what I'm talking about. But I just want to throw it out there too. So like Batman on the left and Wonder Woman on the right, and then you have Superman being embraced by Lois in the center. That's the shot that occurs, right? When he just died.
Yeah.
Right. And so that shot mirrors the Zack Snyder shirt design. And that shot is also mirrored in various scenes in Ballad of Buster Scruggs. And that shot is mirrored in when Joker walks down with the two buildings on the left and right. So there's a consistent symbolism that they're using, which is essentially biblical, or we also can't ignore the Freemasonry illusions Zack Snyder shirt design.
You could literally like put it right over the design.
Yeah, exactly. So all of it, like if you look at Freemasonry, they do that a lot. They do that type of symbolism a lot, where it's like have this pillar on the left, pillar on the right. You have the center that represents either the way to God or the path to God, that sort of thing. And if you look at the main shot for Joker that everyone loves, where he's walking down the stairs, that has that particular symmetry too, where you have the sun in the center, right? You have the sun above in the center. And that's also on the shirt design, where you have Superman, the circle with the rays coming out representing Superman as the sun. Mm-hmm. And so there's a ton that I don't really, I'm not even that familiar with, but even just on a brief look into it, you can see these repeating aesthetic for this type of symbolism. And the 11:11, I think, is related to that, but I'll get into that in the video. But yeah, just dropping some crazy
crazy story. Snyder bombs.
Yeah, exactly.
But he does put a lot of that occult symbolism in there, right?
I mean, it's on the shirt, like
it's right there. I mean, it's
like I might sound a little crazy if he didn't release that shirt design. Like, then you could say I could be reading into that, but
it's obviously a specific design for a reason.
Yeah, exactly. He put thought into that design, right? So that's just what it is, you know, when you look into it. Yeah.
But hopefully we get some more of that in a Snyder cut.
Oh, yeah.
What it's going to be. I wonder what the major theme is going to be of the movie, because
I know.
Tell by the theatrical cut what the hell the movie's about, really. Like,
yeah, right. So, yeah, they could. It's just going to be way different, you know?
Yeah. As far as that character motives go and stuff like that. And, I can't wait to see it.
Right.
Hopefully we'll get it next year on May. But
next year? Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah.
Man, you're optimistic.
Let's go.
Oh,
let's go. Let's go.
I'd love that too. Yeah.
Give my $30.
$30. Do you think HBO Max is going to release it?
It's going to be a launch one. Like, it's going to be a reason for people to buy HBO Max.
Oh yeah.
The only place to watch the Snyder Cut.
They would have to do like some theatrical run, at least like at least minimize theatrical run.
Yeah, the ultimate edition of BVS was theaters, right?
That's true. Yeah. Something like that. Exactly.
Yeah. That'd I would love cool. that.
Fucking yeah.
Love. But yeah. What other things you want to talk about here?
Anything
you get off your chest.
Martin Scorsese, Coppola.
Oh yeah. About the Scorsese stuff, you know, I'm 100% on his side about that.
Yeah, right.
Totally get where he's coming from.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, it's kind of weird that people kind of, you know, get so defensive about that, though. Like, as if Martin Scorsese
is telling you not to watch the movies. He's just saying what the fuck he thinks. Like, that's it.
And would you expect someone like Martin Scorsese to be gung-ho about, like the MCU? Like, of course not. He makes stuff like the Departed and you know, Gangs of New York and things like that. Of course, like Guardians of the Galaxy. Of course, I wouldn't expect Martin Scorsese to be able to sit through Guardians of the Galaxy.
But you know? So it's not a bad film. It's still a very good film there.
What, Guardians of the Galaxy?
Oh no. I thought you meant Guardians of Gahool.
Oh no! I'm talking about Guardians of the Galaxy.
I just heard Guardians. I'm like, yeah, that whole movie's pretty good. You know?
No, that one. No, I agree. That one. That Guardians is good.
Oh, yeah.
The other Guardians, the Dance Off Guardians. I have some problems.
Most let down ending I've ever seen in a movie. Yeah, and people loved it. I don't get it.
Yeah, and do they expect Martin Scorsese to like enjoy that type of stuff? Yeah. Like, why are they surprised? You know. And Coppola, for that matter.
Yeah, the guy who made fucking Godfather. He's gonna love Avengers.
Yeah, it's like, what are they thinking? Of course, they're not gonna like that.
But yeah, Irishman's coming out soon.
I really want to see that.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that one too. I don't know if it's coming to a theater near me. I think I just gotta watch it on Netflix when it comes out. But Yeah.
I think I'd have to drive like an hour away to go see it. So I'll probably just wait on Netflix. Yeah, that one looks good. That one looks good. I have no idea what it's about, but.
Do you think a Joker sequel is coming?
Oh, man.
I think it's a guarantee. But
you think so?
Yeah, because they made way too much money for them to be like, oh, that's it. Coming back to this again.
Yeah, that's true. Once there's that much money on the table, they're like, we got to make another one. I've seen some articles that say it's like for certain going to be released, but is that actually?
I'm thinking that's rumors, the sources aren't, you know, no name sources. Nobody, like, we're hearing from an insider that this might be a possibility.
Yeah, right. That, I mean, that'd be cool to see. I wonder where they would go with that. I mean, wouldn't be able to bring Batman in because they're doing a whole nother Batman.
Then
they'd have like the potential for like three Batmans.
Yeah. George Clooney Batman you could put in there, you know?
Yeah, you could throw him in there. Would they bring in another villain or something? Or like how would that even work?
I don't know. I would love to see a Batman facing off against this Joaquin Phoenix. And like we see the movie from the Joker's perspective the whole time as he's fighting Batman, right? Ooh, so like Batman's just this shadowy figure the whole movie.
That could be interesting, cool. And he's sort of portrayed as like the antagonist, sure.
Yeah, I hope we get something like that. But what do you think about the Batman movie with Robert Pattinson? I'm liking the casting so far. Some people are hating on it, but actors are good.
I mean, I like Robert Pattinson. I like some of the movies he's been in.
Did you see Lighthouse?
No, I want to see that. I want to see that. I was actually looking at a scene before this podcast.
It's insane.
It's like I can't. Is it in the theaters or like where do I even see this? Is it like a minimized theatrical run or what is?
I saw it in theaters like 2 weeks ago or something like that, and I don't even think it's still playing. I think it's a limited release, which sucks. Because it was really good.
So how the hell do I see it?
You just gotta wait until
it comes out on like Amazon or something.
He's great in that movie, and they got Paul Dano in there. Paul Dano's great. Matthew McConaughey might be in the movie.
Oh yeah, right. And who's the other guy who's going to play Penguin?
Oh, Colin Farrell.
Yeah, Is that like for certain, or
I don't think, like, it's official. I think those were
not official yet?
Castings, but they did cast Commissioner Gordon.
And
what's his name from Source Code?
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. And Paul Dano, is he going to be the Riddler or something, or what? Yep,
he's the Riddler.
Oh, that's good.
Perfect casting. I mean, like,
that's
look
true.
At the guy.
That's true. Yeah, he looks looks like a Riddler.
Looks like a creepy ass Riddler.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, no, I'm excited. I mean, I heard there's an interesting choice where they're going to make a blue Batman. Did you see information on that? Like, you're going to have blue and gray or something.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that was his costume design. I think that was like concept imagery that came out, but I would love that. I mean, not too blue. I don't want no like 1966, you know, cartoon.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I don't think Matt Reeves will do that. You know, Matt Reeves is like, if Dawn of the Planet of the Apes is any indication like of how this movie's going to be, I think we're fine, you know?
Right, right, right. Yeah. I mean, I just hope the tone is... Like they said, they're going for like true, like noir detective, you know, kind of gritty movie, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That'd be great. I can't wait to see that if that's the case. Yeah. When is this supposed to be coming out?
2020, right? In the 21. I think they're filming
next year. They started filming. Oh, they haven't started yet. Okay.
Either starting at the end of this year or the beginning of next year, but either way.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that one looks interesting for sure.
But they got nothing on the Snyder Cut. I mean, this is
yeah, exactly. So I mean, that's really the one I'm interested in for the DCEU, technically. So yeah, I don't. How did those like the release the Snyder Cut people? They really came through on like organizing all of that too, like making sure.
Oh, definitely for like the first like 200,000, like. I think after that point, it kind of like went viral. I think everybody that just saw the hashtag started talking about it, right?
Yeah, right, right, right. That's true.
They definitely got the ball rolling with all the advertisement. And they're raising money for suicide prevention. And I mean, they're all over the place. I mean, that stuff gives you so much good press that it's almost impossible to say like no to the Snyder Cut. It's like,
oh, yeah, yeah.
Really? But, like,
yeah, you know, they'll always find a way to kind of be negative about it. But the fact is, there's positive motion, there's positive movement, positive feelings about it. Big actors are tweeting it, you know, like there's momentum here, you know. So that's always like that's just a fact, you know.
Oh, yeah. But yeah, man, I think we had a good little talk here.
Yeah.
At the hour mark. Yeah.
Good talking to you. Glad we were able to get things to work out.
I know, finally. I mean, this was making for a minute.
Yeah, I know. Right?
But we got it. Thanks for coming on again.
Yeah, no, thanks for having me, for sure.
And I hope more people will go subscribe to your channel now.
Oh, yeah.
Seeing this, because you definitely deserve it. Even though you don't come out with videos like every day.
The ones you
do come out with is quality.
Thank you. Yeah, I kind of get off on tangents with the symbolism and stuff and like kind of go deep down those rabbit holes. But I'll actually, now that we talked about this, I feel like I have to make a video to kind of elaborate what I was talking about today.
There's a few Joker ones to do.
Yeah, right, right, exactly. I still have to see that movie again. I haven't seen that since last time, but yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Very good on repeat viewings. I caught a bunch of stuff the second time around.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
There's like giant super rats on camera. Like they're on, you can see these giant rats in the corner of the frames when he's in the phone booth. It's crazy.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Did not notice it at all.
I'm going to look out for that one. Yeah, okay. All right.
Yeah, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me, man. Good talking to you.
That's it for now. We'll see you all next one. Bye.